So this particular module, the private information regarding cost, is the opposite of the private information regarding demand. In the case of demand, the private information was held by the host firm. Here, the private information regarding cost will be held by the foreign firm, okay? Now, how the game and the immediate implication changes? Now, the earlier we had problem of adverse selection when the buyout offer is made. Now we have the opposite. Opposite in the sense that foreign firm is, I'll not be considering any signaling aspect in this model. So it has private information about its cost. So the host firm will have some expectations about the cost parameters that the foreign firm has. And as a result, when the host firm tender its shares in response to the buyout offer, would like to have a guess that what sort of implication will be there in case it rejects the offer. The implication will be that depending on the cost parameter, the host firm's payoff will be determined after competition subsequently, and that would constitute its reservation payoff. But when it is having the reservation payoff, it is based on the expectations about the cost parameters of the foreign firm. Okay, so this changes the structure. So given the expectations about the reservation payoff that the host firm will have, it will decide whether to accept a particular offer or not. And based on that, the game will pan out, okay? So we are considering the, in this case, a simple inverse demand function, which is P equal to A minus Q. A is the standard demand intercept. P and Q are the price and quantities, okay? And this Q will be determined by the interactions of the two firms in a Kurnow-Bayesian games. Now, let us assume that both the firms have the same cost of production. So they have a common marginal cost of production, C bar, to begin with. And then the foreign firm can do some R&D. And as a result of the R&D, it might be able to reduce its cost of production from C bar to zero. And that happens with probability Q. And of course, at some R&D cost, which will remain kind of not of consideration for our model. So imagine that it is worthwhile for the foreign firm to do the R&D. Okay, so the cost is not prohibitive to stop the foreign firm from undertaking that. So we will have this R&D activity of the foreign firm, which can reduce the cost of production from C bar to zero. But that happens with probability Q. So with 1 minus Q probability, the foreign firm would not be able to develop the new technology, which involves zero cost of production. As a result, the foreign firm's cost will remain at C bar. So now what we have because of this R&D is that foreign firm's type is essentially that with Q probability, it could be a very, very efficient foreign firm with zero marginal cost of production. And with 1 minus Q probability, it may be as efficient as the domestic firm, that is C bar as the cost of production, okay? So now the game will have three stages. The foreign firm offers to merge. Host firm doesn't have any clear information about this, only it has expectations that Q is the common knowledge. So Q is the probability that the foreign firm is having zero cost of production, and 1 minus Q is the probability that foreign firm is having C bar amount of cost of production. So foreign firms offers to merge, the host firm either accepts or rejects that offer. And in case of rejection, the foreign firm can choose to enter and the firms compete according to Kurnow. Okay. So here we are thinking that in case the offer is accepted, there is no further entry, but the foreign firm enters only if there is a rejection, okay? So we are truncating the game a little bit as opposed to the previous model that we have developed. We are making this change. Now, so that is exactly the assumption we are making, that in case the offer is accepted, foreign firm operates in the market under monopoly with the best available technology, and so there will be no further entry by the foreign firm, okay? And host firm will be getting the merger price, that will be the offer. Now, given the belief, now I'd like to get some of the expressions from the Kurno Bayesian equilibrium that we have done in the game theory course. So these are standard expressions that we are taking from the Gibbons with the relevant cost parameters. Okay. So now in a Kurno Bayesian games, the host firm's profit will be, you can check, host firm profit will be, after rejection, will be this pi h amount. H represents the host firm, 1/9 a minus c bar minus q c bar whole square. Okay, so you can just simply plug the values in the Gibbons that analysis that is carried out in the game theory book. Okay, so you will get this expression. Now imagine that a pooling equilibrium is being contemplated. So in that case, a same offer will be made, and in that the foreign firm offer will be accepted by the host firm. So foreign firm would merge with the host firm irrespective of its cost relation under incomplete information. So that's the proposition, and we'd like to prove that. Now, merger takes place provided that the host firm gets its reservation payoff, okay, and foreign firm finds it worthwhile to merge. Now, what does that mean, the worthwhile to merge? That means the foreign firm's payoff after the merger should be greater than what it can get simply by entering directly, okay? So now, these are the foreign firm's payoff under Kurno Bayesian equilibrium with the interaction with the host firm. So in case the cost is zero, so this pi f zero type, that means the foreign firm with zero cost of production will be receiving this much amount as the payoff, okay? So this is again the outcome of the Bayesian equilibrium. And that you can easily get from the Gibbons, that particular exercise that we have done. Similarly, in case the cost of production for the foreign firm is C upper bar, then we'll have this amount as the profit of the foreign firm, okay? So these are standalone profit out of the interactions under Bayesian equilibrium. Now, after merger, the foreign firm will be the monopolist and it will use the best possible available technology. So what does that mean? That means in case it has the low-cost technology, it will use that. And in that case, it will get the monopoly profit based on that low-cost technology. Or it will use the high cost, that is as good as host firm's cost, and then it will again have monopoly based on that cost. So now, for the low-cost type foreign firm, it will take over provided that the monopoly profit, that will be a square by four, because the cost of production is zero for the foreign firm. So a square by four will be the profit, monopoly profit, minus this is the amount that the host firm is expecting as the reservation payoff, okay? And if this particular expression, left-hand side, is greater than what it would get, that is simply coming from this expression, that what it will get as standalone payoff without the merger. So if this condition holds, the low type foreign firm would be happy to offer this amount to the host firm and merge. On the other hand, the high cost type foreign firm would take over the host firm provided that this is the monopoly profit with the high cost. And minus, this is the payoff that has to be, these are the same. This has to be given to the host firm. So this side should be greater than what it would be getting as a standalone firm after interaction with the host firm. So this is the payoff.
So this reservation payoff is the profit under Kuno competition?
No, the reservation payoff is profit under Bayesian Kuno. Because the reason is that the host firm doesn't have information. I can only have a guess, and based on that guess, I am just expecting that what would be my payoff tomorrow. The guess is that with Q probability that the I will be interacting with a firm which has zero cost. With 1 minus Q probability, I will be interacting with a firm which has zero cost. And based on that, I am calculating my own profit. Clear?
Yes.
Okay. So now, based on this reservation payoff, that would be the bare bone that the host firm will always expect, because simply by rejection, it can ensure that amount, right? Because no information is revealed to him. And in the next stage, after the rejection, the Kuno-Bayesian games will be played. And based on that, this will be the profit of the host firm. Okay, so this remains the common reservation payoff. And if the foreign firm has to acquire this domestic firm, it has to offer that much amount of reservation payoff, irrespective of how much is its own cost of production. So essentially that it has to calculate that if it has zero cost of production, this is the monopoly profit. So is it worthwhile to purchase the domestic firm by paying this amount? Similarly, is it worthwhile to purchase the domestic firm by paying this amount? Okay. And the point of comparison is that if it does not purchase, then there will be Kuno-Bayesian equilibrium, and in that it will be getting these payoffs based on its cost of productions, and they are different. You can check that. Now, routine calculation shows that both these conditions hold. Okay, so that means that if you just take basically simplify these expressions, and then you will be able to get a condition under which all the profits expressions are greater than zero. So essentially A will be greater than C bar and all, and 2 C bar and all. So that assumption, based on that assumption, you will be able to find that these two conditions will be satisfied. I may not have explicitly mentioned that assumption, but A will be greater than C bar for sure, okay? To get all these profit expression positive, okay? So A has to be greater than C bar. Okay, so these two conditions will hold. You can simplify them and check that they indeed hold. Now, that would mean that the asymmetric information, although with respect to the technology, is there, present, but it is not a hindrance for the merger to take place, okay? So the merger is taking place without any problem, and the foreign firm would be happy to take over completely by paying this fixed amount to the host firm. And this fixed amount is the expectation that in case there is a competition under Kuno-Bayesian equilibrium, this will be my payoff. Okay, so I'm happy to sell out, provided that I'm assured of that amount. Okay, so now we are changing the structure a little bit just to highlight that it is not the asymmetric information which is a problem for merger, but maybe some other kind of issues. And that issue here we will be highlighting is that the nature of the technology that we are thinking could be drastic in nature, okay? So this C2, so now we are changing the cost structure from, let us suppose that the both firms have C1 cost. Okay, earlier, if you remember, there was C upper bar, and then there will be some technology development, and that will give you zero cost. But now we are changing that. So they are starting off with C1 as the initial cost of production for both firms. But due to the R&D successful innovation, the foreign firm will be able to generate a product technology which will involve a cost of marginal cost of production, which is C2, okay? But this C2, this new technology C2 is drastic. Now, what does that mean? That means in case this technology is introduced in the market, then the opponent, the rival, will get zero profit, okay? Why? Because this technology involves so little, so less cost that the foreign firm can easily charge the monopoly price without being threatened under any competition, because the other guy's cost of production will be above that price that the foreign firm will be charging when it has the technology C2. Okay, so this C2 is the drastic technology, and in Tirol you have a good definition along the same line as I stated, that a technology is said to be drastic if it is introduced, all other firms go out of business. Okay, so here all other firms means only one, and that will go out of business means that given this cost of productions, it's the profit of the rival will be zero. Okay, so the C2 is that much less. Now here we are making another imperfection, in a sense that the entry of the foreign firm is not feasible if it has high cost. However, entry is feasible when the foreign firm has low cost. So we are just distorting the structure in a manner that we have already seen that asymmetric information is not the real reason for not merger, but we are going to show that real reason for not merger lies in this nature of the technology as well as the relevant condition of entry. And the relevant condition is that if the foreign firm is having the high cost, then it is not worthwhile for foreign firm to enter given the fixed setup cost of entry. On the other hand, if the foreign firm has low cost, that is a drastic technology, then it can enter and monopolize the market, and that profit will be greater than the cost of setting up. Okay, so it is feasible. But, and also we assume that there is this, though the foreign firm will be actually under C2 technology, foreign firm will be able to get the PIF C2. So this is, there is no competition because of the drastic technology. However, in case the entry occurs, we have assumed that in entry is not feasible if it is known to everyone that the foreign firm has cost of production, which is C1, okay? But you never know. Suppose the entry happens, we have to specify all the possible subgame and their outcomes. So in case there is an entry and there is a competition between the domestic firm and the foreign firm under C1 technology, which is the high cost technology, then this is the duopoly payoff. Okay, this is a simple duopoly payoff that can be thought of under this linear demand with C1 technology. Okay, so now a sufficient condition for the entry to be feasible for low cost foreign firm and not feasible for the high cost foreign firm is given by this. So PIF C2 must be greater than F in order to justify that in case of high cost, in case of low cost of production, foreign firm will find it worthwhile to enter, and if entry occurs, then it will monopolize the market. On the other hand, the entry is not feasible because the setup cost is higher than the duopoly profit that might ensue between the host firm and the foreign firm, and the corresponding duopoly profit is lower than the setup cost F. Okay, so under this crucial assumption that entry is feasible under high kind of better technology, which means low cost of production, on the other hand, entry is not feasible when there is high cost of production. Okay, and these are all standard kind of practical thing, because you know that some firms will have lower cost, some firms will have higher cost, and the firms which are more efficient, they typically venture out to different countries, become multinational, and the firms which do not have that cost advantage, they remain within their territory and doesn't venture out because of the cost disadvantage. Okay, so here we are considering that if the MNC, the foreign firm, is successful in innovation, then it can come to this domestic economy. But if it does not have this better technology, it cannot come. Okay, so this is the idea we are basically taking in this assumption. Okay, now, so in case of successful innovation, the host firm will receive zero by rejecting the merger offer, because after merger offer, the entry will take place, and entry takes place means entry is done only by the low cost foreign firm. So in that case, it is a drastic technology and host firm will receive zero. Okay. On the other hand, if the fund firm is not successful in innovation, the host firm can receive the monopoly profit, okay? Because you can easily see that host firm will not be able to justify its entry because of this reason that post entry, the duopoly profit that it will get will be lower than the fixed setup cost. So as a result, the entry will not take place. And if entry doesn't take place, then host firm knows that if I reject the offer and if the cost condition of the foreign firm is C1, then it would not enter. And in that case, it would be my monopoly preserved in the market and my monopoly profit is pi C1, okay? So now, what is the host firm's expected payoff? Host firm's expected payoff is, in case the foreign firm is having a C2 cost technology, then I will get zero profit. That because of the drastic nature of the technology. So Q into zero will be the profit, expected profit in case the foreign firm has the new technology. Plus one minus Q into foreign firm would not enter in case it has high cost technology. That means it is not successful in innovation. So in that case, my payoff will be pi C1, this monopoly. So my total profit, expected profit will be Q into zero plus one minus Q into pi C1. And this we call define in terms of a new term called R bar. So this is in essence the expected payoff that the host firm will be getting if it rejects the offer. Okay. Now, what would be the challenge for the foreign firm? Foreign firm's challenge is whether to buy out the host firm by paying this arb, okay? And that's the consideration the foreign firm has to make, okay? Now, if you remember, the similar kind of reservation payoff was constructed when we didn't introduce this problem of entry feasibility. There, the assumption was that entry was feasible. We have looked through the Bayesian Cournot equilibrium and we have established that it is worthwhile for the foreign firm to offer that reservation payoff and MART. But now the foreign firm has to consider that given that it is not able to enter, so this particular reservation payoff has to be given to the host firm. So is it worthwhile to give the entire amount or is it better to enter and then compete? Compete means that if it enters with the drastic technology, it will be the monopoly and the host firm will go out of business, okay? So now we will have two types of equilibrium, pooling and separating. Now pooling means that a single offer is made, arbor is made, and this arbor is less than equal to F, okay? So here, given that this reservation payoff has to be met in order to merge with the host firm. So this, when this arbor is less than F, now look at the problem from the perspective of two different types of foreign firm, one with C2 technology, one with C1 technology. Now C2 technology, that means with the drastic technology, the foreign firm is thinking that if I enter, I have to incur this setup cost. Whereas if I buy out, I will still have my C2 technology, which I will use in the market and get the monopoly profit out of it. But in the process of taking over, I am just spending arbor amount, okay, just to merge. So this arbor is lower than F, so the foreign firm with low cost will find it worthwhile to merge, okay? Well, how about the other firm? The other firm, that means the firm with the high cost. Now the firm with the high cost, if it merges, what will be its payoff? Remember, the firm with the high cost, that means C1 cost, the foreign firm, that type, if it merges, it is paying arbor. But this arbor is lower than pi C1 because there is a probability attached to it. So it's a fraction. So it is actually paying a fraction. And after the merger, it will be able to get the spicy one as the monopoly profit in the market. So both types of foreign firm would find it worthwhile to pay that arbitrage amount and enter and merge with the host firm, okay? And the entry would not take place. So this is the pooling equilibrium. Both types are choosing to merge at the price arbitrage, and it is worthwhile for both types to do that. However, if the condition is reversed, that means arbitrage is greater than F, strictly greater than F, then neither type of the foreign firm makes any merger offer. The low-cost type foreign firm with the new technology enters directly to monopolize the market, and the high-cost type foreign firm without the new technology stays out of the host market. Okay, so in case this arbitrage, the amount that has to be paid to the host firm, is greater than the setup cost, then the low-cost foreign firm will think that I will rather spend this amount F and enter, because post-entry, given my pricing that I will be charging under my drastic technology, the other guy will not exist in the market and I will have my monopoly profit. So it is a better thing for me to directly enter rather than buy out at Arbor. On the other hand, the high cost type foreign firm will then see that if the low cost type is not buying out and entering directly, and if any offer is made by this high cost type foreign firm, then immediately that offer reveals that foreign firm must be a high cost type firm. Otherwise, in the condition, low cost type foreign firm will never find it worthwhile to make the offer of merger. Okay, so low to cost type is not merging, and as a result, high cost type, whatever offer is being made, the host firm will immediately understand that this is the bad guy. Bad guy means that it has high cost of production. Then I know if I reject, this guy will not be able to enter and I will be able to keep my monopoly. Okay, so the host firm will not accept. So then, based on this anticipated behavior of the host firm, then the foreign firm, the two types foreign firm will take two different actions. One is directly enter without any merger offer. Another one will also not make any merger offer and stay out of the host market. Okay. So the above proposition is the market imperfection in the form of high entry cost may lead to no merger being formed. Okay, so this is essentially the purpose of this asymmetric information related to cost and how it affects the merger prospect. So it is not the asymmetric information, because we have established that under Bayesian Kurno, where the technologies are not very different, but they are different, but they are not very different, and entry is always feasible, and we have seen that it is possible to have a merger. But when we have this high entry cost, that only with a better technology the firm can enter, but with bad technology firm cannot enter, we have seen that there is a separating equilibrium where no merger is formed. Okay, so with this we are coming to the end of this particular issue, where the assumption was of a bilateral merger between the two parties. Okay, so now we will move on to our next set of papers, and those papers are not in terms of bilateral merger. Okay, so let me give you the glimpse of what we will be doing in the next set of papers. So you know that So these particular two papers that I have discussed, they are from my PhD thesis, and there the assumption was that there are two entities, one is host firm and another is foreign firm, and the entire merger story was happening. Okay, but here we have not introduced any complexity with respect to that these entities can also be held by large number of shareholders. Okay, so for example, think of any firm, and if it is it has some public shares in the market, then you or me can hold the shares of those. Okay, and when you do so, then In practice, although the management will be doing most of the activities on a day-to-day basis, but in terms of the real owner, it is you and me. We are holding shares. And in case there is a merger or acquisition attempt by any other firm, it is not possible simply by making the offer to the managers who are managing the firm, because they have to buy out the shares, which is actually the ownership right on the firm, from all of us, you and me. Okay, so that creates another layer of problem, and that problem we'll be discussing. And those are classic problems. And then the three papers that we'll be doing is Grossman Hart, where we'll highlight the free rider problem of takeover acquisition when the shares are diffusely held by many people. Okay, here the takeover was easy because you are actually negotiating with only one entity and who is assumed to hold the entire amount of shares, okay? But in real world, we'll see that most firms are actually having shareholders, and shareholders are the real owner of the firm. And until and unless the shareholders tender their shares to this new company, who is a raider, which is trying to take over, is not possible, because the raider, until and unless it gets the ownership right from these existing shareholders, it would not be able to make any changes in the management or introduce any new mechanism or management system or better technology through which it can improve the performance of the firm. Okay, so this is the essential difference. That so far we have been focusing on bilateral merger, but now we'll be moving on more broad-based aspect of all these acquisition and takeover stories, where the firms are not actually held by a single person or a single entity, but it will be held by a large number of shareholders. And these large number of shareholders can be really infinite, in a sense that it is really very minimum amount of shares everybody is holding. And then the problem will be of certain kind. And if we have large shareholder, that would be the second model in this stream, that is Slifer and Bisney. How that existence of large shareholders actually helps in doing the acquisition. And the third model will be on some kind of randomization strategy within this kind of asymmetric information world. And we'll see how that actually help in terms of getting the acquisition done. Okay. So this is any question? So can you see this new slides where takeover bids, the free rider problem, and the theory of the corporation is shown? Can you see this?
No, sir. We can see the earlier one only.
Okay. So I have to stop share and then share again. Yeah. Can you see now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I exactly have this entire stream of this video, which is about 36 minutes. Okay. So I hope to complete in today's class itself. Okay. So let me just begin with this Grossman and Hart. And as you will be learning, these are really, really interesting paper and some of the most exciting part of this particular course. So you can see this paper, Takeover Bids, the Free Rider Problem, and the Theory of the Corporation.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is Grossman Hart. Now these three papers that we'll be discussing in this as a sequel to the first two that I've already discussed. So my papers were essentially in the context of bilateral merger. Okay. Or acquisition or takeover, whatever way you want to interpret. Okay. So in other words, one party is coming and trying to take over the other guy. And the problem it is facing is that there is not clear information, either in one case with the target side. Now what we call target is the firm which is being taken over. Okay. Or from the raider side, who is coming and raiding the firm. Okay. So These are bilateral, one radar, one target. So the two papers that we have completed is in that framework. Now we are going into a bigger issue. This issue is that most of the modern corporations are held by shareholders. And in most of these companies, you will typically find where the shares are traded in the stock market, the companies are typically atomistically held, which means that there are thousands and thousands of shareholders. They might be holding very small amount of shares, okay, in the whole process. And they are known as atomistic shareholder, okay? So given that they are really small shareholders, then how to go about taking over such firm? Because the radar who is trying to take over the firm now not only needs to negotiate with one, but it has to negotiate with thousands. Okay, so obviously that's very difficult. And that kind of mechanism, the way it is designed in the corporate world, is to make tender offer that I am going to buy shares at this price. Anybody who has the share of this particular company can tender their share to me, okay, and I will pay this specified price, and then they will be able to get that, okay. So now look at the change in context. Earlier it was bilateral, one person owning the firm, another person is targeting to take that over. So the entire issue was playing out with respect to these two parties, and depending on their two-sided asymmetric information, which were analyzed one at a time. So now when you have shares which are diffusely held by large number of shareholders, then the problem of takeover is serious. And in that context, this paper is an early contribution in this literature, and it was in 1980. Okay, so this was the 1980 paper. So this talks about that when you have so many shareholders and there is a raider which is coming and raiding the firm, potentially with the objective of raising the value of the firm, then every shareholder can realize that in case the raid is successful, then there will be increase in value of this particular firm. And if that happens, then what would be my incentive to tender my share today if I believe that the shares will be valued more tomorrow? And as a result of that, nobody would like to tender their shares, okay? And if that happens, this is a situation of free rider problem, that I want every other person to tender their share so that the takeover takes place and the value of the company goes up, and then I will enjoy the benefit as I am retaining my shares, but I do not want to tender my share. So it is like this famous public good problem where everybody wants the other people to contribute, whereas they do not want to contribute but still enjoy the benefit of that contribution. Okay, so this is the free rider problem, that they want others to submit their shares but they do not want to submit their own shares. Okay, and because of this free rider problem, nobody will tender their shares, and as a result, takeover will not take place. Now there is a broader context in the literature which is with respect to that how the managers should be disciplined. Because managers, we have talked about that they typically have objective which is different from the shareholder. Now, in that context, the issue that is coming up, that when a firm is badly managed, managers are not doing the good things about maximizing the shareholders' value, then the outside parties will realize the potential of this particular firm in terms of increasing the value. So that realization will lead to some raider appearing in the horizon and raiding for the firm, and thereby displacing the manager and increasing the value of the firm. So that is the logic behind that. To some extent, the managerial behavior will be disciplined because of the threat of corporate takeover. Okay, But Grossman-Hart in this particular paper is highlighting that if you have diffusely held shares and the shares are held by atomistically a small shareholder, then because of the free rider problem, you may never see any takeover possible because everybody would expect that the shares value will rise tomorrow. Nobody will tender and no raider will be able to successfully raid a farm and take over the farm. Okay. So then what is happening? Even if a farm is very badly managed by the existing managers, there is no chance, absolutely no chance in terms of the outside raider coming and taking over the farm, and thereby the threat of takeover would discipline the manager. So that possibility is completely not there because of the free rider problem. So that's the highlight of this particular paper. Now, having said that, how to deal with such problem then? Then Grossman-Hart talk about that in case a particular farm is subject to this kind of free rider problem and still there are better raider available who can improve the value of the farm. So in that case, it is good to have in the company charter some kind of dilution factor embedded in the company charter. Now, what is the dilution factor? So essentially, in case there is a raid which is successful, the raider is allowed to dilute certain percentage of the total asset value in different ways, okay, so that it make it in kind of it attractive for the raider to come and raid. So for example, if I take over say some company, then I might be able to get certain benefit in terms of selling off certain divisions at a very high premium price, and through that I might get some other kind of extra payoff. Okay, so in other words, by selling that strategic unit, the shareholder's overall value might go down, but that will help me when I am at the helm of affairs being the raider, and then after successful raid, I will be able to utilize and exploit that critical asset in a manner that I get extra payment, which the shareholders would lose in the long run. Okay, so they will not be able to take the benefit of that critical asset that the raider will dilute in terms of its value. Okay, another possibility is this sale could be to the raider's original entity. So in other words, there can be a price at which the raider, who is now the managing the farm, can simply sell off certain divisions to his own farm so that the overall shareholders value gets depleted. Okay, so this is the dilution factor, and this dilution factor, then if it is incorporated in the company charter, then that might attract some raider. And then the next question is that is it worthwhile to incorporate such a dilution factor which will attract raider, and then raider subsequently dilute some amount of share value? Now, the answer to this question is that it is optimal to have the dilution factor for the simple reason that without such dilution factor, you will never see any raid being successful because of the free rider problem. Okay. Now, if you allow this dilution, then it might be attractive. And because of that, it might be possible for the raid to take place and there will be successful raid. And given that possibility of successful raid, there are two ways it helps. Firstly, it helps in terms of disciplining the manager, that managers would know that there would be raid because of the dilution factor that is incorporated already in the company charter. And secondly, the value increasing takeover can take place. So in other words, that I would not, as a shareholder, I would not remain stuck at a low value because of the managerial lethargy or their own different objective, but there will be raid in future and there will be some probability of those successful raid, which will improve my value of the shares. Okay, so the shareholders will be willing to bring in such a clause in their company charter. Okay, and they can be incorporated as part of the company's rule book. Okay, that what happens in case there is a successful raid, how much percentages of value that the raider will be allowed to dilute and all that. Okay, so this is the idea which is being explored. Now, you read this paper. So A naught is the initial activity for through which is chosen from a set of activity. Then Q is the status quo value that the farm is enjoying right now. Okay. Now, if there is a tender prize, then that prize P, which is offered by the raider, this P must be greater than Q, because if P is not greater than Q, then nobody will tender their share. They are happy with what they have. Okay. And so that gives you the condition one, that P must be greater than equal to V, and otherwise I just jumped a step. So P has to be greater than Q, that is for sure. Okay. Otherwise, why should you at all tender your shares, given that Q is already assured by your existing manager? Okay. Now the question is that the raider can improve the value to V, okay, by choosing some other activity from the same set of action, and there can be some uncertainty parameter epsilon also, but overall the value that will be generated by the raider is V. Then the question is, then how much should be the tender price? Now imagine the tender price is lower than V. Now this is exactly the free rider I have described in words. So if P is less than V, then everybody knows that tomorrow, after the raid being successful, V will be the value of the shares. So if I tender today, I will get P. So as a result, I will not tender. And if nobody tenders, raid is not successful. So P less than V is not possible. Okay. So no shareholders will tender their shares at P less than V. So for shareholders, for raid to be successful, there is a necessary condition that P has to be greater than or equal to V. Now, if P is greater than or equal to V, then the raider is offering you more than what it can generate. Okay. And then on top of that, if there is a cost of taking over, then it would not be able to cover that cost. Now, because of that reason, if P is greater than or equal to V, then no, there will be no raid will take place. Okay. Even if Q is, so you can see my cursor here. Okay. Even if Q is very low, no raid will take place. Then what is the way out? Way out is to incorporate some kind of divergence between the shareholders' value and the raider's value. Now, how that divergence will be created? Now, the divergence will be created by incorporating explicitly a dilution factor so that the value to the shareholders after the raid is this VS, okay, which is lower than V, and it is adjusted by the dilution factor. So then the profit of the raider will be that it can generate V. The value to the shareholders is VS. So if it gives that VS to the shareholders, then all shareholders will, having the perfect foresight that tomorrow the value of the shares will be no more than VS. So it's better to tender, and then V minus VS minus C is the takeover cost. So this will be a total payoff to the raider. Okay. So if VS is sufficiently small as compared to the value that the raider will generate, that is V, then raids will now occur. So that's given by your condition two. Okay. So now to create this divergence, we are introducing this dilution factor phi. So now VS will be equivalently defined as the amount the raider generates minus the fee, which will be the dilution factor. Okay, this fee. So what is needed? That your tender price P, at which you plan to buy shares from the atomistic shareholder, must be greater than or equal to V minus phi. Okay, and based on that, that if it is so, then there will be the shareholders will be willing to tender their shares. Okay. Now also it is important that if V minus phi is less than Q, bid can take place at below the status quo market value Q. Okay. But we will not be considering such kind of takeover where the hostile kind of takeover takes place, where the outside bidder is offering something to the shareholders which is lower than the status quo profit. So we will not consider such kind of thing, and we will rule out this particular possibility, and as a result our tender price must be greater than equal to Q. So in other words, to incorporate a little bit of extra rationality on the part of the overall model, that only the value increasing takeover is being focused, and in that case the fee should not be so high that V minus phi is less than Q. So we avoid that aspect, and to in that case the tender price must be that P greater than equal to Q. So in that case, what would be my tender price? Tender price must be max of either V minus phi or Q. So in case you incorporate phi, which is large enough in the company's charter, leading to that this particular V minus phi is lower than Q, but in that case also the tender price must be such that it is at least covering the status quo value of the shares, that is Q. Okay. So the tender price now is defined as P equal to max of V minus P and Q. Any questions so far?
No, sir.
No, sir.
Okay. So now if this is the tender price, then you can easily look into the algebra that what would the raider's profit then. Now we know raider's profit, raider will be able to generate small v minus this is the price it is offering minus the cost has to be covered C. So V minus P minus C will be the raider's profit, and then we can simplify by saying V minus max of V minus phi Q minus C, and which can be written as minimum of T V minus Q minus C. So this five is essentially the profit of the raider. Okay. So that will be the raider's profit. Okay. Now this will be positive if V and V minus Q both exceed C, otherwise not. If one of them is lower, then you can see from the definition of the mean function. And raids will take place under these conditions. Okay. So the condition five is necessary for any raid to take place because this is the raider's profit and that has to be positive. So the effect of dilution is happening in terms of reducing the tender price to some extent. Okay. So P is max of V minus phi Q, okay? But that's only to a limited extent because P is again with a floor of Q is being maintained by the raider because we are considering value increasing takeover. So now if there is this kind of takeover possibility and raid, what would be the manager's choice? Managers will choose its activity in a manner to maximize the profit, and that profit will incorporate that how much, what is the probability of raid, and based on that probability of raid, it will get some expected profit. So you please read all these. I will cover some of them in my next class. Okay. So if in case of no raid, managers will be sticking to the status quo, and then UQ will be the utility of the manager based on Q is being produced. Okay. And that happens provided that no raid occurs, and no raid not occurring means this particular condition being satisfied. On the other hand, zero will be the payoff for the manager if there is a raid, because we are assuming that raid essentially implies that the existing managers will be will be displaced, okay, by the new set of managers, okay? And as a result, they have to go out of the farm, and we are assuming that the outside opportunity of the manager is zero, okay? They lose the job and they don't get anything. So now there will be some probability based on the random element that we will be introducing with respect to the value V and the cost of rating C, okay? And that would generate the probabilities of takeover. So those definitions are also given here. Pi PQ is the probability of takeover that the condition for takeover for the raider in terms of positive payoff is satisfied. Now, if you allow the distribution is there for V tilde and distribution is there for C tilde, then you will be able to get a probability for which these condition is satisfied, okay? And then the utility, expected utility from producing a status quo profit Q will be given by WQ, which will be the UQ is the utility that the manager gets in case of no rate, and 1 minus pi PQ will be your probability of no rate. So this will be the expected payoff that the manager will get given by the equation 7. So is it clear? So now I'm stopping my class here for today, and you are advised to go through the paper very carefully.